Greetings, Field of Dreams fans, and welcome to the second episode of the Field of Dreams Movie Sites podcast, The Dream Nation Show. I'm your host, Roman Weinberg, and our guest this week is a very special one, an author that has written over 12 books and is a professor of English at Lipscomb University in Nashville, Tennessee. He wrote both his master's thesis and doctoral dissertation on Kinsella's baseball stories, and yes, I am referring to W.P. Kinsella, the author of Shoeless Joe, which inspired the movie Field of Dreams. Dr. Steele had the pleasure of interviewing and getting to know W.P. Kinsella and actually write his biography, and it is entitled Going the Distance. It is already in sale in Canada, as you will hear from our interview, but is actually going to be released in the United States on April 21st of this year. And for those of you that don't know, that is the exact day, 30 years ago, that the Field of Dreams debuted in theaters. So without further ado, here is my interview with Dr. William Steele. Hey, Field of Dreams fans, I am here with the author of the biography of W.P. Kinsella, Going the Distance, Dr. William Steele. Dr. Steele, thank you very much for taking the time with us today for this interview.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, you're welcome. So let's start with, how did your love for the Field of Dreams movie begin?
You know, it's funny, when the film came out in the summer of 89, there were a group of us, it was a group of friends, and my brothers and I went out to the movies, and everybody else wanted to go see the new Indiana Jones installment, and I had seen the preview for Field of Dreams, I don't know, a week or two before, and so I was the only one of our group. I went and sat by myself in a theater and watched that movie. And, you know, 16-year-old kid, I got hooked by the story and then found out later that, you know, there was a book that had inspired it. And so that's kind of what got me started with not just the film, but with Kinsella's fiction. I had never read any W.P. Kinsella work up until that point. And, you know, 16-year-old kid, I thought it was a pretty cool story. And, man, I was hooked from the opening credits.
Wow. That's awesome. So what impact has Kinsella had on your life and your career aspirations from that point?
Yeah, it's funny. I tell my students, a lot of times inspiration will strike in different ways, and you never know when or how that's going to happen. And there was no way in 1989 I could have known the trajectory that my life was going to take based on making the decision to go see that movie. But a few years later, I was working on my master's thesis and needed to come up with a topic. And so I thought, well, if you've got to write something, you know, that detailed, it should be something that's going to hold your interest. And so I wanted it to be something with baseball. And so I chose to look at the Field of Dreams and Shoeless Joe. The one was the book and one was the film, and dealing with fathers and sons and the relationships and how baseball is used in both mediums. And I thought, you know, they let me do that. It's kind of a one and done. And then fast forward a few years, and I'm working on my PhD, and they needed to have, you know, I needed to propose a dissertation topic. And so I went and looked at all of W.P. Kinsella's baseball novels at the time, and kind of explored the ways in which he uses baseball to address types of identity in his work. And and when I finished that one, I thought, well, now I'm finished with Kinsella. When I graduated, my dissertation director told me I needed to get it published, and so I sat on it for a few years because I was kind of fried at that point.
Sure.
And I ended up submitting it for publication, and then in the fall of 2011, ended up publishing A Member of the Local Nine, which is an expanded version of my dissertation with McFarland Books. And then I thought, okay, really, I'm done with Kinsella at this point. But what's funny was there was a guy in Canada who had gotten a copy of that first book and had passed it along to Kinsella. And I don't know how much you know about Bill Kinsella, but he was somebody who hated academia.
Yep.
He taught 5 years, and he just did not enjoy it. And, he and I were so different in a lot of ways, and he hated literary theory. He thought that, you know, too many literary theorists spent time looking for meanings that weren't there. Well, my degree is in literary theory. And so I get this email several weeks later that said, hey, this is Bill Kinsella, and this guy had loaned the book to Kinsella, and he was very complimentary of it and said, you know, you don't jump to absurd conclusions like so many academics tend to do, which is still one of my favorite lines that Kinsella ever wrote, was basically telling me, you didn't screw this up too badly. And so I thought, well, that, you know, that was kind of cool. Well, a couple of weeks later, he reached out and said, hey, I've got an idea. Feel free to tell me no if you're not interested, but, you know, I'd like to have a biography done. I should have had it done years ago when people were more interested in my work. And not knowing what I was getting myself into, I thought, sure, I'll do that. So, I mean, really, my entire academic career now, I've been working on, you know, baseball literature, sports fiction for years. It turned into me editing. I edit a journal, a journal of baseball history and culture published with University of Nebraska. I co-direct the Nine conference every spring in Arizona. And so it really has helped me to establish kind of my own little corner of academia with baseball literature. And I never could have imagined that when I went into the movie theater that day.
Well, and that's got to be quite a feeling for you as well to really give back to someone that you have idled for so long, you know, since 1989. So it must have been quite an experience for you.
Yeah, it's been kind of surreal. I told him at one point, I said, you know, this is almost like something out of one of your stories where somebody just kind of stumbles into this kind of, you know, this situation where all of a sudden he's writing about this guy, and it's been a lot of fun.
That's great. So I have to ask if there is any interesting fact that you stumbled across while interviewing Mr. Kinsella to write his biography. Was there anything that threw you for a loop while doing your research?
You know, it's funny because having spent the better part of 6 years working just on the biography and then, you know, about 20 years going back to my master's thesis, you know, I thought, well, I had a pretty good grasp of who Kinsella was. A couple of things that I thought was, you know, really interesting is the amount of, you know, for somebody who's known now as a writer, the amount of time in his life when he wasn't writing. You know, he graduated from high school in 1953, and he worked jobs that he hated. He worked for the Canadian government. He sold insurance. He sold Yellow Page ads. He ran a pizza business. I mean, he did a little bit of everything and wasn't writing. He had gotten married and had two daughters fairly, you know, young. And he ended up not writing for, you know, until really the early 1970s when he decided to sell his pizza business and go back to school. And then when he went to Iowa to the writer's workshop there in the mid-70s is really when he started writing for real. It was 1977 when his first book came out. And then from 1977 to 97, he's writing, coming out, you know, for better part of a decade, averaged a little over a book a year. And, but then he was hit by a van in 1997 and he said he lost his sense of smell and taste. And, perhaps most troubling for him was losing the ability to write creatively, which he didn't do for, you know, 11 or 12 years. And so, really, if you look at his life, the 80 years he was around, or 81 years, he really didn't write all that much, which I thought was really interesting. And then the other thing, you know, he always claimed, and I asked him about this several times, he always claimed that he never wrote used his own wife. He didn't write autobiography. But when you start reading about his life, you realize how much of his life and his family and personal history he uses in his stories. You know, the story of his dad playing baseball that starts off Shoeless Joe, you know, where Costner narrates it at the beginning of the movie. You know, that's his dad, you know, telling him stories about baseball players. His dad was an American and grew up watching these players and listening to their games. And so he, you know, he would incorporate things of his own life in there. And so later on, shortly before he died, he kind of admitted that, well, maybe he had used more of his own life than he had led on, but he was still adamant that it wasn't autobiographical. So.
Sure. Was there any stigma in the public eye that people had of Kinsella that you have found not to be true through your time researching him and having known him?
Yeah, so when he died, I remember I was just bombarded with phone calls and did a series of interviews with various Canadian radio shows and newspapers. And a lot of people had this conception that he was really just almost like an angry, mean-spirited man.
Yep.
And I understand where they get that. You know, some of his more popular stories in Canada are based on a group of Native Americans on a reservation. And, of course, as a white man writing about indigenous people, you know, a lot of people started saying it was cultural appropriation. And he was very adamant, arguing against that and saying that that's not what it was. And so some of those arguments got really intense. He and a guy named Rudy Weeb went back and forth for years about this. And so a lot of people picked up on that and saw him as being this angry, just mean-spirited guy. But the more research I did, the more interviews I did, and digging through literally thousands and thousands of pages at the Canadian Archives, he was incredibly opinionated and absolute in his opinions, but he was incredibly welcoming to aspiring writers and to fans. He did a lot of work in the writing community, helping up-and-coming writers to get published and providing advice. And he would oftentimes go back to Iowa during the summer and teach for a week at the Summer Writing Institute there. And a lot of the writers who went there would fill out these evaluations, and I've read dozens of these things where they were all incredibly thankful for the opportunities that he provided for them, the feedback that he gave them, and things like that. And so it was one thing to be able to see the people who saw him as being this angry, some have even described it as being very bitter. But, you know, while he was very, very certain and absolute in his opinions, he was somebody who was also could be very kind and welcoming as well.
Sure, sure. So I have to ask you, have you ever been to the Field of Dreams movie site?
I have. I've been there twice, and I was talking with my wife the other night. I had taken her once. The first time I went was about 20 years ago this summer. I was moving from Tennessee. I was moving out to Portland, Oregon, and went way out of the way. Had a U-Haul, and I was pulling a pickup truck on a trailer, and I kind of went out of the several hundred miles out of the way to go to the Field of Dreams site, and
sure.
Just fell in love with it. I mean, it was, it was one of those perfect Iowa summer days, and it was absolutely beautiful, and just sat there and kind of watched, families play and catch and hitting the ball back and forth, and it was a lot of fun. And then a few years, two or three years after that, my wife and I were driving back to visit some family, and I dragged her out. I thought she needed to see it as well.
That's great. Yeah, your story starts with, so many others is I was in the area, or I had to make my way out there, even if it's a couple hours trip off the beaten path. They needed to come out and see it. So I enjoy hearing those stories. If there were one message to take away from the film Field of Dreams, what would it be in your eyes, and why?
Oh, goodness. I've lost count of how many times I've seen the movie. And my kids, when I put the DVD in now, or if when it's on TV, they'll get up and leave. Here he goes again. He's watching it again. I love the idea of people pursuing their passions, their dreams, whatever you want to call it. And no matter how absurd it is to, never give up on those things. The iconic lines from the movie is, as everybody who's listening to this will know, when the voice says, "If you build it, he will come," and then later on says, "Ease his pain," and then towards the end, "Go the distance." The one that's left out is the one that's one of my favorite lines in the book, is where the voice also says, "Fulfill the dream." A lot of times people will start things, they're really passionate about something, and then because the rest of the world is looking at them like they're crazy, or convinces them that they need to be more realistic, people step away from those dreams, from those interests. And I love that last line. It's like, fulfill that dream. Keep doing what you want to do. The the line in the novel that is one of my favorite lines in all, you know, all of literature is the one that Moonlight Graham says, hardly anyone recognizes the most significant moments of their lives when they happen. And there's no way I could have known in the summer of 89 that how significant that moment of me going in and watching that, that movie was going to be. But, you know, I tell people, tell my students all the time, no matter how crazy is it, you know, it may seem, just never give up. Keep pursuing what you love.
Yeah, a big reason why we attract so many fans even to this day is because of the life lessons that you can extract from the movie. And a lot of people that haven't read the book don't know about Fulfill the Dream, but you're right, it is a basic lesson, and it's got a beautiful message to it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So is there a sense of pride or nostalgia for you that you wrote the book Going the Distance, and it's going to be released here in the United States on April 21st, which is to the day 30 years after it was released in theaters?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to lie. I think that's one of the coolest things ever. when the publisher was talking, you know, the book came out in Canada back in September, and we were going back and forth talking about when we were going to release it in the spring. And, you know, we were thinking, well, you know, baseball season in the U.S., you know, spring training. And then as they were doing research, they said, hey, what about 30 years to the day? And I was like, I mean, they didn't have to twist my arm at all. I thought that was the coolest thing. And knowing that, you know, 30 years ago this summer is what got it all started for me, I think it's very fitting that it's going to be on that day. And to be honest, you know, two of the guys that, you know, whose work I respect, you know, Bill Kinsella with his baseball writing and Phil Robinson in Hollywood, you know, who made the movie, I think it's really cool to be able to just have a connection to those two guys and their works. And, you know, I would also like to think it's going to get me back up to Dyersville with my wife and kids maybe later on this year. So,
yeah, hey, maybe we'll see you out for the 30th.
Absolutely. I'd love that. So.
Well, that's great. So, all right, Mr. Steele, where can fans buy your book?
Right now it's available in Canada, Amazon.ca, and, of course, Canadian bookstores all over the place. And then, as you said, April 21st, it comes out in the U.S. It'll be, you know, it'll be available on Amazon, of course, but also encourage people to visit their local bookstores, especially the local bookstores. You know, we don't have enough of those anymore, so always support those folks.
Sure, sure. Well, hey, thank you again, Dr. Steele, for taking the time to talk with us today. It was a pleasure.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you so much for having me on.
Yep, thank you.
So there you have it, Field of Dreams fans, my interview with Dr. William Steele, author of W.P. Kinsella's biography, Going the Distance. I do really encourage you to read this book. I have and certainly learned a lot about Mr. Kinsella and his life. It is truly remarkable. And if this podcast gives you the baseball fever and want to come out and see us for yourselves here in Dyersville, Iowa, please do so and visit our website to learn about all of the interesting things that you can do here and all of the fun events that we have coming up here in 2019. You can look at our events calendar on www.fieldofdreamsmoviesite.com. And we are particularly excited about our 30th anniversary celebration on June 15th. Of Father's Day weekend, that is a Saturday. Gates open at 10:30, and tickets are just $10 a person, with 14 and under in free. And this event is presented by American Trust and Savings Bank. If you would like to learn more about this, please visit our website, and there is a page specifically for the 30th anniversary. We have a lot of things planned that day and hope you can come out and join us for what is sure to be a magical day. And that is all we have for you on this episode of the Dream Nation Show. Once again, I'm your host, Roman Weinberg, and stay tuned for our next episode 2 weeks from this evening when we interview author Daniel Helfingstein. Have a great weekend, everyone, and as always, keep dreaming.